Good afternoon and welcome to ThinkTech Hawaii's Likable Science. I'm your host, Ethan Allen, and I appreciate you joining us again. We are going to talk about a very likable topic today. We're going to be talking about water and groundwater in Hawaii in particular, but we're going to be looking at it through a different lens, the lens of team science. Lots of science these days has become more complex, where science is no longer done just as biology or just as chemistry or just as physics, but the kinds of projects that are done require people from very diverse disciplines to step together, to step into teams and work together. And today we have three guests here, all associated with the Ike Wai project, Peter Adler, Gwen Jacobs, and Greg Chun, the former from Accord 3.0 Network and the latter two from UH. So maybe start out by telling us a little bit about what Ike Wai is, Gwen, and why, sort of how it is a diverse team.
Oh, great. Yes, thank you, and just delighted to be here. So Ike Wai is an EPSCoR-funded project funded by the National Science Foundation.
So just since our viewers probably don't know, EPSCoR is an acronym?
Yes, EPSCoR is an interesting acronym. It stands for the Established Program to Stimulate Competitive Research. This program specifically funds research projects that are of benefit to the state.
Right.
And Ike Wai, which was funded last year, is focused on water sustainability, has four main components. One is a research component to try to understand more about how our aquifers function. The second is a capacity building and education component. We're recruiting new faculty at both Manoa and UH Hilo, educating graduate students and postdocs. The third is a significant community engagement piece, because all of the research that we do, we want to translate into hopefully help for decision makers in the state. And the fourth is an infrastructure project for which we will be building a centralized data repository of water data for the state.
Excellent, excellent. And I know, Peter, you've been working with them on this whole team science business. So why is this a challenge here?
Well, you know, and many of your listeners would know, and observers, that so much of historical science was done by sole researchers working on great big things, whether it was Gregory Mendel or whether it was Madame Curie. But science doesn't work that way anymore. Once in a while, but more often, it's big enterprises, well-funded, well, not always well-funded, but funded, and with teams of different people, and more it's interdisciplinary. So social scientists and physical scientists and biological scientists need to find out how to work together on a common problem. So that's where the team science piece fits into this. Team science is basically a number of researchers or a number of teams of researchers who are working on common questions.
Right, and the public may not typically realize it, but scientists sort of grow up speaking different languages, right? They learn the language of the discipline they're trained in, and the biologists learn how to talk about different species and different biological machinery. Physicists learn to talk about phenomena in their own language. And it gives people very blinders almost, right? They begin to focus in more and more narrowly, and so getting teams to work effectively together is a real challenge. And then there's the whole other challenge, which is this business you mentioned about engaging the broader community. Uh-huh. And Greg, that's a big part of what your role is, right?
Correct.
So what are the particular challenges here?
Well, you know, the internal challenges, as we've described, are really sort of bringing people who come from different disciplines and have different terms of art and different models and different approaches to their work, and figuring out a way to how you bring that together.
Mm-hmm.
This project also has the additional challenge of ensuring that our research is aligned with the decisions that policymakers and regulators, in this case water regulators, are needing to make. And that involves bringing in a whole other set of interests, and issues, language, approaches, priorities. And aligning the science with the decision support needs sometimes is a bit of a challenge, because there's a lot of translation that has to go back and forth both ways. Translating the needs, the policy needs, the decision-making needs to a science hypothesis or problem, and vice versa, taking that technical information and translating it into a policy decision or policy implication.
Right, right. And this is complicated too by the fact that lots of different people have vested interests in our groundwater supplies, right?
Absolutely.
And rather, unfortunately, rather different interests. Mm-hmm. So the agricultural community, mm-hmm. the military has interests in it, the average person on the street, the communities wish to preserve the land, mm-hmm. all of these people, the tourist industry, and a number of these groups actually have considerable, shall we say, legal interests in the groundwater of Hawaii. So we have to sort all this out in this project too, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, one of our partners that we're partnering with in the project is the USGS, the water branch here, because mm-hmm. they have been building a lot of the hydrological models in the state for many years. So we're partnering very closely with them. I think also the way we designed Ike Wai is it's really designed as one integrated science project, mm-hmm. other than a set of parallel projects that we hope will knit together at some point. So each of the components that I mentioned before, all four components are really interrelated. Mm-hmm. So the stakeholder work will drive the type of science questions that we work on. The science then also drives our ability to recruit new faculty and new graduate students, and then the infrastructure platform needs to support it all. Huh. So all the members of the team really have to understand each other's science and understand each other's languages. So that's a significant challenge because we have geophysicists, geochemists, software engineers, social scientists. Yeah, it's a very mixed bag.
Right, and so you've dealt with some of these kinds of challenges in past projects. Do you see unique ones here, unique challenges?
Well, this is a wonderful project, first mm-hmm. Let me just say this is a fabulous project, and it's a sizable grant and brings a lot of new intellectual firepower into the state to work on some pretty tough issues. Mm-hmm. These disciplines do need to work together. No one discipline has all the answers. The economists can't answer it. Hydrologists can't answer it. So it's a dispersed problem and a dispersed knowledge set. And that's the trick here, is to bring, for Gwen and Greg and the others, to bring that together to try to answer some common questions. It's uber questions, superordinate questions.
Right. So what do you... That's sort of the next question. What are these sort of big driving questions here?
Well, just at the science level, and also, right. again, this is really driven very much by the needs of the decision makers in the state. And what we've learned just through much of our initial research, and I think this has been known for some time, is that we don't really understand some of the basic aspects of how our aquifers work. We don't understand how much water there is in the aquifers and how long it will last. We also don't understand well the pathways in which water flows through the aquifers, which has all kinds of implications for management boundaries as well as contamination issues. So it's a very complex science problem in and of itself, and then also integrating all of the stakeholder needs and feedback also adds another dimension to it.
That water just won't stand still.
Right.
It just won't stand still to be
right.
studied.
And the other challenge is we're dealing, every island, because of the age differences of the island,
correct.
Presents a different subsurface geology. Mm-hmm. And all of that impacts greatly how those aquifers operate.
Right, and it's not just like a bunch of water sitting there all in one big bolus in the middle of the hills that you can just sort of draw out, right? There are impermeable and permeable regions, and there are sort of contained water that's held up separately from others. And as this gets explored, I know particularly on the Big Island, they found more water, much deeper, mm-hmm. more fresh water, much deeper than they expected, mm-hmm. which I suppose is good news, right? But it is surprising to many people when they hear, oh, we have 30 years of water left here on Oahu, which should worry you anyhow, because mm-hmm. that's not a very long time. But to realize that we really don't have any real clue about how much water there is. I mean, we really don't have much estimate at all,
it's
right?
It's not precise.
Yeah. It's true. And I think, and also the other challenge for us that really is a unique Hawaii challenge is about the geology. We live in a volcanic island, so many of the models and techniques and approaches that might work well in California or other areas won't necessarily work for us, because we really need to understand that substructure in order to have a good representation of how things will work, how the aquifers, where water flows.
Yeah. Right. We have water that flows in and then flows out under, mm-hmm. off the coast and into the ocean as fresh water. that we never sort of see, right? It passes through the whole island, and that doesn't tend to happen in a continental system, right?
It's true, and we also have wells in which when they test the age of the water is 4,000 years old. So that suggests that that's coming from a well that's completely contained and may not, and is unlikely to be replenished.
Right, yeah.
On a regular basis. Yeah.
And that's, of course, then the other part of this is, right, our state is growing quite rapidly. Our water needs are increasing probably even more rapidly than our growth. And how can we figure out where to develop, where to look for water, where to get our water from, plus how to, of course, dispose of our wastewater in ways that are going to be as sort of sustainable as possible, right?
And a lot of people want to live in places that are dry. Mm-hmm. And sunny, and have a golf course and a swimming pool, so there may be plenty of water, you know, just around the corner, but it's not there. So there's a lot of movement that may need to happen, and you really need to study that so you don't overdraw it.
Sure. I mean, we saw, I mean, the big agricultural boom of Hawaii's past actually drained some of the high-level aquifers, right, and streams stopped flowing out of the mountains and things because literally the water table from some of the very highest water just dropped. So it's a sobering thought because we don't want that to happen too much further down.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the one variable that is known, we can tell pretty much accurately how much water we're pumping out, right? We can make probably some guess as to how much water comes in from the rainfall. Mm-hmm. But beyond that, there's really everything else is pretty gray, right?
Absolutely.
And you mentioned submarine freshwater discharge. Right. I mean, that's an area that we really don't understand. I mean, some of our researchers have looked at the freshwater coming out at the coast, but as you indicated on the Big Island, there's clearly a lot more water coming out at much deeper depths, and that's a variable that we have really very little understanding of.
Right, and it's critical. If the whole island is really a quick and simple flow-through system, then a few years of drought will very rapidly lead to very serious problems. If instead there's large reservoirs and what you're seeing draining out is indeed a tiny fraction of what's coming in, and for many years earlier, then it's a different business, right?
Given what is clearly emerging now on climate change, sea level rise, getting more precision on water for water management, understanding how aquifers do and don't connect, where the pockets of water are and aren't, that's going to become even more of a pressing issue.
Exactly, and it's pressing not just here on Hawaii, but on any Pacific island.
Right.
And it's, I mean, Ike Wai, as big and complex as this problem is, it's looking really at only two aquifers, one on Oahu here and one on the Big Island. And yet, even here on Oahu, we have 9 or 11 major aquifers or something. So it's, all we're seeing is a little slice, and we're trying to get a handle on that to begin to understand it well so that we know how to apply that same measurement technique, that modeling technique, to the other aquifers, right?
Absolutely, and I think some of the work that's been done by the Freshwater Council, led by the Hawaii Community Foundation, has really looked at this in detail to try to really look carefully at what our risks are. And so it's well established that the amount of rainfall that we're getting is decreasing over time. And we have some very long-term records of that from some of the work of Tom Giambaluca at UH. But all indications is that rainfall is decreasing in some areas, and also differentially, more on the dry side than on the wet side. So that bodes poorly for for our sustainable water supply.
Exactly. A lot of challenges in upcoming years to face, and we're going to talk more about that when we come back. I'm your host, Ethan Allen, here on Likable Science. With me today are Gregory Chun, Gwen Jacobs, and Peter Adler. We're all talking about team science and Ike Wai project. Please join us again right after the break.
Hey, everybody. It's Ian, social media manager here at ThinkTech Hawaii. Thanks for tuning in. I'm sorry to break into your show. If you're listening on the podcast, thanks for listening, watching on YouTube. We appreciate the subscription, etc. If you are a longtime listener or viewer of ThinkTech Hawaii, you would know that we are on every day, 5 to 6 hours a day, basically streaming stuff that's happening here in Hawaii that matters to everybody worldwide, basically. There's a lot of stuff that we got going on, and we're excited about many of them. 2017 is going to be really cool. But right now, I can tell you that we are on iTunes, where you can listen to all of this stuff now. We're really, really excited about how that's going. And we have just started on the street feature, where we take a camera out to the street and stream live to you guys out there, and getting what people in the local community out, what they want or are thinking about, and sharing that with you. We're really excited about all that stuff. We're really excited about you guys watching and following us on all the social media sort of things, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, all that good stuff. Look for us, ThinkTech HI. Watch us on Olelo. Thank you so much. Everybody here appreciates it. Hello.
And you're back here on Likable Science on ThinkTech Hawaii. I'm your host, Ethan Allen. I'm here with three wonderful guests today, Greg Chun, Gwen Jacobs, and Peter Adler, all involved in various ways with the Ike Wai project, studying Hawaii's groundwater. Before I get back to our next question, so I do want to put in a little plug for an upcoming event, the March for Science on Earth Day. If you don't know about it, go to March for Science Hawaii and find out about it. Well worth it. Now, so we talked in sort of some general terms in the first part about the challenges of cross-disciplinary communication. Also, mm-hmm. So what are some of the techniques and methods you use actually to get the physicists talking to the hydrologists, talking to the social scientists?
Well, one of I would say that the center of gravity at the moment is really trying to put together a partnering agreement, a compact, mm-hmm. In which people have some common understandings of the rules of the road for the next 4 or 5 years as they work this. And those are going to include things like authorship or data, how we're going to handle data sets and what can be made public at what stages. Some of it will be agreement to the fundamental values, which are pretty well articulated in this project. So we're putting that together. We're right in the process of stitching that together and cohering people. And that includes communication plans, some organizational structures, making sure that everyone understands who reports. And part of it is the performance of what they've signed on to do in exchange for receiving support. But the other part of it is also making sure that we get that cross-disciplinary crosswalking going mm-hmm. on. So that what Kim Burnett does on the economics is in consort with what Ali El-Khadi or Steve and Anthony are doing on hydrology, and on what others are doing on the chemistry and the geophysics and the engineering of that. So the whole idea is to say, are we focused? Are we talking right? Are there anomalies in what we're seeing? In other words, there's one person discovering something that says, no, what you just discovered, that doesn't make sense here. So that's where we want to get to. But the starting point is this compact.
Right. And that helps because it's a sort of iterative process building that. Mm-hmm. It really forces people not just to talk to each other, but actually to listen to one another, probably even more important.
And sign on to some ground rules.
Right. And that's a really good thing to establish, that kind of basic, we're all on the same team here. It gets almost to that whole idea of what's sometimes called collective impact, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Well, and also I'd say the other challenge we have is this is a very young team. We have many young investigators on this. Also, this team has never worked together before. This is the first time we're all embarking on this kind of grand experiment. And we're also a distributed team as well. So we have a whole team over at UH Hilo, which we're using different methods to try to communicate with. And we'll be bringing new individuals to the team on as we recruit new faculty and postdocs. So this agreement that we're putting in place will really be our guiding document to hopefully steer the project.
Excellent. And you were speaking of some of the technology, so the cyber canoe?
Yes, they're cyber canoe. So we're working very closely with Jason Lee's lab at UH Manoa, and he's developed this great technology that allows you to not only have a very large scale screen display to be able to put all of our data up there, but it also works very well as a collaboration environment. So we have just finished the installation of a new cyber canoe at UH Hilo, and we have one at Manoa, and so we'll be able to communicate with our colleagues there. And that kind of face-to-face, even though it's virtual, is really essential for a project like this.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I was also going to say, piggybacking off of your earlier question to Peter, that another sort of element to the complexity of the project is, as we talked about earlier, the need to align with our stakeholders' interests and needs. So there's a whole other set of expectations and rules of the road, if you will, mm-hmm. that for many researchers and academics, they've not been used to operating under or by. So that adds another element of complexity to bringing this team together.
Sure, and you want the products of this team and the project to be very useful on several levels, be very useful sort of as a research tool, but also to be broadly useful to lots of different communities to ultimately be able to take this and say, oh, we can find out more about our water on our island, be it Chuuk or Palau or wherever, right?
Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And you know, a huge challenge, and this is a challenge for many large science projects, is to be able to take the research that we do, the new and innovative research, and translate that into something that can actually be used by the stakeholders. So one of our grand challenges that we're taking on is to develop decision support tools for our water managers that will leverage our research, our data infrastructure, and many of our hydrological models as well.
Right, and that decision-making process and having it be an informed process, informed by the best possible science. And again, that ties back to my earlier plug for mm-hmm. the March for Science. That's what the March for Science is all about on a, mm-hmm. on a larger scale. But it plays out here in the same exact way, right? So given that we have these very diverse audiences, Greg, how do we ensure that we're hearing all the voices that need to be heard?
As you can probably figure out, communication is a huge responsibility of everybody. Mm-hmm. And a huge coordination task, both internally and externally. And so what we're trying to do is set up really relationships with the water managers, the regulators in the state, where it is an iterative process, as you indicated previously. We're going to be learning together. We're already learning mm-hmm. some things. We're learning about some decision support needs that we did not anticipate, that we did not That's know true. When we put the proposal together. Factors that they are now needing to consider in estimates of state sustainable yield, like impacts to coastal systems, coastal ecosystems, or impacts to traditional customary rights. How do you integrate those kinds of factors into estimates of sustainable yield? Mm-hmm. That's not stuff that we had anticipated, and so this is going to have to be this iterative process. And the only way we can do that is if they become part of the team, mm-hmm. essentially.
I was going to say that sounds like basically the MOUs you were referring to have to be, the partnership agreement has to be sort of expanded to include this ever larger group of more and more diverse interests, which
That's right.
makes the language of it an ever greater challenge, right?
And one of the things we've been learning is that as we, Greg and I and some others on the team have been going around talking to the water managers and allocators and regulators, and they're pretty hungry for tools. They're hungry for very practical kinds of things. So that's one of the bridging pieces here that has to happen between sort of town and gown, if you will, and to use an old phrase. I mean, it just, we can generate a lot of curious questions and interesting things, and researchers follow their noses and they love it. But, you know, there's people downtown who say, I could really use a visualization tool or a new framework, an analytic framework for this or that, and we're learning what they want.
Yeah, and I mean, clearly the large-scale developers need to know you don't want to stick up a 1,000-room resort and suddenly realize that you don't have any water available
right.
nearby, right?
That's right.
So somebody needs to know that, and it's that translation of the research into actual, practical, usable terms is a whole sort of second-level challenge that many academic projects never face, right? Yeah. Many of them are content to stay within academia, basically.
Yeah, absolutely, and I think so two things that have happened already that are really encouraging, as Peter was saying, and Greg and I have been on many discussions with different stakeholders, is just how much we've been welcomed in terms of this project, and also how willing they are to share their data. So, and this is something I didn't know initially going into the project, is just how difficult it is to do water research in the state because the data sources are distributed, they're not well connected, they're hard to access. So it's very hard to get the data that you need to do a particular study. And so part of our infrastructure build will be to try to collect those data sources together and then serve that back out to the decision makers so they will have access to this, all these tools and this data.
Right, so part of that process has to be that communication issue where you mm-hmm. help everyone understand that really we are all on the same team, even if you're from the agricultural community and you're from the Department of Land and Natural Resources and you're from the Board of Water Supply. fundamentally, we all want the same thing here, right? We all mm-hmm. want to, you know, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years down the road, have plenty of fresh water to drink.
I often describe this project as much a cyber infrastructure project as mm-hmm. it is a hydrological modeling project, mm-hmm. Because the decision support tools that we are able to create are going to be really dependent on Gwen and her team. Mm-hmm. She happens to be director of cyber infrastructure.
Which is helpful, very helpful
because it's such a big part of our ability to do that translation and build those kind of tools.
Right.
You might mention also the nexus over to Hawaiian historic knowledge. I think that's a really unusual piece.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, one of the components of the project is we have a group of researchers who are looking at the archived Hawaiian newspapers that have now been digitized, mm-hmm. and looking for stories and references to water in our two study areas to see what our kupuna were saying about water as they knew it mm-hmm. and understood it. So that research is just beginning. There's a few little things that have started to come out. Accounts of Hawaiian farmers drilling and finding water on what we now call Ford Island, for example. Mm-hmm. And so that information will help us sort of focus some of our data collection and also help us focus better understand how water was actually being managed mm-hmm. And utilized in these areas.
Mm-hmm. Right. I think it's a really interesting piece of this because it connects sort of historic knowledge that is being revived or sought out and, you know, recreated in new forms with contemporary science. Right. So it's trying to put these pieces together. It's another cross-disciplinary walk.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, and I mean, even the Hawaiian term vai, right, for water, when you do it twice, five eye, it's wealth, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which suggests that the Hawaiians had a very deep understanding of what really counts in life, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
If you don't
I think in addition to the newspaper work, we're also going to do interviews, and this gives us the opportunity not only to learn more, but also to communicate this project to many of the local residents. So that's mm-hmm. a really exciting part of the project as well.
Excellent. By drawing them in, of course, you hopefully get sort of a better reception for the project. And
mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
The communities that we're working in really need to, they're beneficiaries of this work. They're the ultimate beneficiaries mm-hmm. in some ways of this work. Huh. So they need to be part of this process as well. And to the extent that they can actually provide us further input to the science and to the research, that's great. But we want to make sure that they understand sort of the water resources that they're relying on to live where they do live.
Excellent. Well, I want to thank the three of you, Peter, Gwen, Greg.
Great pleasure.
It's a great pleasure having you on, talking about these interesting intersections of team science and Ike Wai itself. I look forward to further conversations, perhaps, about these, and best of luck with the project.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You've been watching Likable Science, and we'll be back next week with another show. Here.